Good morning and welcome to our service here in Greystones Presbyterian Church. Wherever you may be watching this from, you are very welcome. Thank you for joining us as we worship our amazing God. Before we get into our service, we've just got one or two announcements. The first one is just to say tomorrow, Monday at 12 noon, Terry will be back in his shed, so please tune in for that. Then on Wednesday at 12 noon, I will not be in the shed, but I'll be somewhere else on Facebook Live. Don't know where, but please tune in if you can. Then looking forward to next Sunday, we're not going to have our own service next Sunday, but rather our Presbytery, Dublin and Munster Presbytery, will have put together a service using many of the churches in our presbytery. So it'll be shown at the same time, 11 o'clock, in the same way on YouTube. So we want to join together to worship with the whole presbytery. Our guest speaker for that service will be John Woodside, who many of you will have heard of. He was a minister for many years in Kilkenny Presbyterian, and then laterally he was in Drogheda Presbyterian. So John's a great guy, a very godly man, and it'll be wonderful to hear what he has to say to us. So that's next Sunday at 11 a.m., a presbytery service. And just finally to say that Joyce Lee has got something to share with us, a very important announcement about the why. Thank you, Joyce.
Good morning, everybody. I'm here just to remind you about a Zoom prayer meeting, which is being organised by all the churches in Greystones to pray for the future ministry at Coolna Graina, the YWCA, or the Y as it's more commonly known. You may have seen this poster, which has been up on our Facebook page and is on the website. So basically, the YW has been closed since March 2020. It didn't even reopen in the summer when restrictions were eased. And the Youth Cafe, which is state of the art, absolutely gorgeous, and all finished and ready to go, has never really got off the ground again because of COVID. So the local churches would like people to come together and just ask the Lord for a vision for the decision makers, for the board of the YWCA in Ireland. We would like to pray for the staff at the at Coolna Graina, John and Lisa Ellis, and just to seek the Lord and ask for a new direction for this amazing facility that is situated right in the middle of our town of Greystones. So if you would like the link, please email me or phone me. The details are on those posters on the Facebook page and on the website. I will probably send a good number of people the link anyway, those that I know are interested, because so many of you supported the coffee mornings that we held to fundraise for the Youth Cafe. So I know that there is a lot of interest out there among you all. So please do join in and pray. Let's pray together so that the ministry at the YW can continue to build the kingdom of God. Thank you.
Thank you, Joyce, for that announcement. Today is the end of the week for prayer for Christian unity. And I think even in that announcement that Joyce made, it shows the unity that we do have in our town. Because we want to come together collectively, many churches, but to speak and pray as one voice for the future of the YWCA. One of the beautiful things about being a minister here in Greystones is that the church leaders do like each other. We get together frequently. We have some laughs. We have some tears, perhaps. But we meet, we pray, we talk, and we plan. There's a great bunch. We've got Luke and Nanaz, who's just come recently. There's Hugh in Hillside. We've got David in St. Patrick's, David and Rebecca. And then we've got John and Jared in the Holy Rosary. Great people. It is always wonderful to meet together. And so today, as part of our service, there'll be a few unfamiliar faces to you, perhaps. John is going to be doing our Bible reading from Revelation chapter 2. And then there'll be a few others from other churches who will help us in our prayers of intercession. But the theme for this week, or for the theme for the prayer for Christian unity, has been John chapter 15. And I'm just going to read the verse that is very applicable for us, and that it's the theme for the week. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. It's a verse that we've had many times before in this church. But to remain in him, and when we do, we will bear fruit. That's very much the theme of our sermon today in Revelation chapter 2. So, we're going to come and worship our God. Last week we thought about Revelation chapter 1 and that wonderful image of the risen, exalted, and glorified Christ. And that's the one that we come to today. A God who is not distant, but a God who is near. A God who is not weak, but a God who is powerful. And he's with us today. The one who was and who is to come, the risen Lord. And so we sing together, come, people of the risen Lord.
People of the risen King, who delight to bring him
And so we come together to pray. So let us come to our God in prayer. So Father, we come, people of the risen King. We come to you, our amazing Lord. Father, we thank you that we come to worship the one who is living, the one who is exalted. We thank you, Lord, that we come to the one who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Thank you, Father, that you are the living God who pours his life into us. Lord, we thank you for that wonderful image that we had last week in Revelation 1 about the risen Christ, whose eyes were like blazing fire, whose feet were like burnished bronze, who had everything a king, a priest, a judge would have. Thank you, Father, that he sits on a throne. Our God is a risen and reigning God. Thank you, Father, that we can take comfort in that. And as we live in a world so confusing, a world that has been turned upside down in recent times, thank you, Father, that you sit on a throne. Nothing takes you by surprise. You are sovereign. You are in control. And so we come to you, our exalted Lord. And as we do, Father, we recognize our own smallness and weakness and frailty. We recognize it all too much, all too often. So, Father, we come in our weakness, but we come to sit at your feet. We come to hear your voice. We come to be restored and renewed. We come to have a fresh vision of you, of your church, and of our place in it. So let's just take a moment's quietness as we come to him and we say, Lord, you are great, but I am not. There are things I need to confess, things I need to say sorry for. So let's take a moment to do that and say sorry for the things that we need to say sorry for. Lord, thank you that we can rely and trust and be assured of your forgiveness. Thank you, Lord, that whenever we come confessing our sin and confessing our need, you are God, the one who is able to forgive, the one who is able to renew. So, Father, we come to you today. We come to lift our hearts and our lives in worship. Lord, Lord, shine so that we may see you, speak so that we may hear you, for your servants are listening. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everybody, and greetings from Holy Rosary Church here to our friends in Greystones Presbyterian Church during this special week for all Christian churches as we celebrate Church Unity Week. And this year the theme, as you know, for Church Unity Week is that if we abide in Christ, that we will bear much fruit. And as Christian churches here in Greystones community, we have given great witness over the last number of years by the unity that we have displayed in our prayer, in the witness that we have given, be it on a Good Friday or on a week-to-week basis. And we as leaders in the Christian communities, be it Gary or myself or Father Gerard or Canon David Mungavin or Luke or Hugh, we have worked hard on trying to build that sense of community and that we are bound by the Word of God. And this morning, I'd like to read from you from the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. And it speaks to the church of Ephesus to remain faithful to the Lord, that they will bear fruit. And that is our own prayer during this Church Unity Week, that all of us as Christian communities, that abiding in Christ, that we will bear much fruit in the lives that we lead and the witness that we give to to each other and to our wider community. So to the angel of the church in Ephesus write, "This is the message from the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand and who walks among the seven gold lampstands. I know what you have done. I know how hard you have worked and how patient you have been. I know that you cannot tolerate evil people and that you have tested those who say they are apostles but are not and have found out that they are liars. You are patient. You have suffered for my sake and you have not given up. But this is what I have against you. You do not love me now as you did at first. Think how far you have fallen. Turn from your sins and do what you did at first. If you do not turn from your sins, I will come to you and take your lampstand from its place. But this is what you have in your favour. You hate what Nicolaitans do as much as I do. If you have ears, then listen to what the Spirit says to the churches. To those who win the victory, I will give the right to eat the fruit of the tree of life that grows in the garden of God." The word of the Lord. So my prayer for you as a community and for all Christian communities in Greystones, that's in abiding in Christ, that we will, as communities and together, bear much fruit in the witness that we give to the Lord. God bless, and in these days, keep safe. God bless. Take care.
So today we get to study a very important letter. A very important letter in the Bible. Often in the Bible we read and study the letters of Paul. He wrote 13 of them. Or sometimes we'll read and study the letters of John. He wrote 3 of them. Or maybe Peter, he wrote 2 of them. But today, we're reading one of the 7 letters written by Jesus. It can't get any better than that, can it? And this first one today is the letter to the church in Ephesus. Don't know if you've ever been in Ephesus. I'd love to go. I've looked at lots of photographs of the ruins and what it would have been look like. It's, of course, one of the 7 churches that are in the province of Asia Minor, which is modern-day Turkey. And if you look at where they are on a map, if you see that, it's a kind of, I don't know, a kind of semicircle. But it was on a particular route. It was almost like, or perhaps it was, a postal route, where if your postman was coming around, this was the route that he would follow of these 7 churches. And those are the churches that we're going to be looking at over the next number of weeks, and the letters to these churches. But Ephesus was an amazing place. Now, over the last couple of weeks, as we have looked at Revelation, we've discovered that it's written for a very practical purpose. This isn't simply a book with lots of imagery and a bit weird. It's written for a very practical purpose because Jesus reveals the future so that the church can prepare for it. Very practical. It is to equip the church to have courage in the face of opposition. In fact, this is written to prepare many people to die for Jesus. What John sees and records in chapter 1, as we have thought about in our prayer, is this image of the glorified and risen Lord Jesus. And this vision is meant and will give people strength and courage. He has defeated death. He has defeated death. He's now risen. And the book is all about him. As I said last week, this book is all about him, just like every book in the Bible is all about him, pointing to him or telling us what he's been doing, but it's all about him. And here we have this wonderful vision of the risen Christ. Because you see, without a clear vision of him, our faith may falter. But when we have a clear vision of who we serve, the one who loves us and the one who gave himself for us, when we have that vision, well, nothing is impossible. So perhaps you've been to Ephesus in Turkey. Many tourists go there today. Oh, maybe they don't go there today because of all the travel restrictions. But people have gone in recent years to see Ephesus. I've got friends who have been there. And you can certainly see on the internet, wow, some of the things that are there, the ruins that have been left behind. They want to stand in that ancient place and feel the atmosphere. But you know, 2,000 years ago when this letter was written, 2,000 years ago, people still flocked to Ephesus because it was one of the major cities of the world. It was like the London or the New York of its day. So this isn't a backwater. This isn't a little village. This is a happening place. It was a major trading center. It had a wonderful harbor. Ships came from all over the world bringing their goods for sale. So a lot of trade was done there. It was also an intellectual center. If you go there today, you can see the Celsus Library. It was once one of the greatest libraries in the world. Ephesus was a rich city, a diverse city, a very cosmopolitan city. But it was also a place of pagan worship. It had many temples to many gods. But the most important of these was a goddess called Artemis, or Diana, the goddess of fertility and life. Ephesus was the center of the cult of Artemis, and here stood a massive temple, which was one of the seven wonders of the world. It was huge. It was 1.5 times as long as a football pitch or a rugby pitch, and 1.25 times as wide. It was just vast, and pilgrims flocked here from everywhere. So much money came into the temple from those who were visiting. So much money came in that it became a banking center. It became a museum. It also became a place of refuge for criminals. And with its hundreds of temple prostitutes, it was also a city rife with sexual immorality. Yet in the midst of all this was a group of followers of Jesus. Paul spent more time in Ephesus than he spent anywhere else. He was there for 3 years. That's a long time. He taught in the synagogue for 3 months, and then he moved to the hall of Tyrannus, and he taught there every day for 2 years, from 11 o'clock in the morning to 4 o'clock in the afternoon, in that hall, every day for 2 years, teaching, as it says in Acts 19, so that all the Jews and Greeks who lived in the province of Asia heard the word of the Lord. What commitment he gave. God did extraordinary miracles through Paul, did amazing things through him. The church had a huge impact on society, and the church grew rapidly. Acts 19 tells us how, it says this, many of those who believed now came and openly confessed their evil deeds. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burnt them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. 50,000 drachmas. A drachma was the equivalent of a day's wage. You can do the maths if you like, but it's a lot of money. Yeah, this was an effective church. It changed lives. It impacted society in a big way. It was so effective that the silversmiths of Ephesus, the silversmiths who made and sold little gold replicas of the temple, they began to see their business plummet. It was bad for business. And so what did they do? Well, they got together and they weren't happy. They took to the streets and they shouted, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians! Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" They did that for 2 hours nonstop. They went down to the theater and just kept chanting. Wow, there was a riot, actually. The whole city was in uproar. You can read about it in Acts 18 and 19. Yeah, the gospel shook things up in a big way. Now, as you read Paul's letter to the Ephesians, which is a good thing to do because it ties in with this letter, but as you read Paul's letter to the Ephesians and his two letters to Timothy, Timothy was also a pastor in the church of Ephesus, you will see Paul asking believers to live lives worthy of Jesus. You'll hear him saying that they should have Christ-centered relationships within a family, within their businesses, within their wider community, you will hear Paul saying to forgive their enemies, to show compassion to all, to show love to everyone. And this was in a pagan culture whose God said nothing of these kind of things. He asked them to be like Christ in a Christ-denying world. But the greatest threat of persecution came from what had become the major religion in the Roman Empire. It was the imperial cult, worshipping the emperor as God. Now, in the time of Julius Caesar, people treated him like a god because he did so many amazing things, and they said, "You must be a god because you're so impressive." And on his death, he was officially recognized as a god. But his successor, Augustus, didn't want to wait until he had died to become a god. No, he said, "I am a god." He wanted to be recognized as a god, and he ordered the temples in this area of Asia Minor, temples would be built for the worship of him, Augustus. And by the time this letter has been written, by the time Revelation has been written, Domitian is the emperor. Now, Domitian, along with Nero, was one of the emperors that most brutally persecuted the early church. He commanded that once every year, every Roman citizen throughout the Roman Empire had to stand before his statue and pledge allegiance, saying, "Caesar is Lord." Then they would take a little pinch of incense and put it on the flame of the altar as a sacrifice to Caesar. Everyone had to do that. If you refused. Now, this is what the church is facing and will face in the days to come. But the wonderful thing is that despite the persecution, the church has done really well. Jesus, in his letter to them, commends them. He reminds them in verse 1 that he's walking among them. He is in the midst. He walks among the lampstands. Remember last week, we were thinking about that. The lampstands represent the churches, for the churches are the light in the spiritual darkness of the world. So Jesus is walking among the lampstands. He is in their midst. Can't it sometimes be so easy to forget that? We cannot do church. We get into the rhythm of church. We do what we do. But how easy it is to forget that Jesus is with us. He doesn't stand at a distance. He's up close and personal. Jesus is with his church, and he knows exactly what's going on. Remember those blazing eyes? Nothing is hidden from him. Nothing at all. And he knows exactly the state of the church in Ephesus. And this church has done brilliantly. Verse 2. "I know your deeds." He knows. "I know your deeds, your hard work and your perseverance." Isn't that wonderful, getting that kind of commendation from the Lord himself? "I know your hard work, your deeds and your perseverance." This is a church that has been doing amazing things. If it was today, if this church was here today, this would be a church you'd want to join. I know I would want to join it. An active church, well known in the community. A place where everyone is serving, where everyone is using their gifts. A place where the teaching is good. The music is good. The youth work is good. The children's work is good. The pastoral care is second to none. The sick, they're being cared for. Who wouldn't want to join a church like that? People are working hard for the kingdom. And despite the many challenges of living in a pagan culture under a cruel emperor, they persevere. Nothing puts them off. Nothing holds them back. And when it came to orthodoxy, well, they were spot on. They had been taught well the truth, and they stood by the truth. Paul had taught them well. Others had taught them well. Their orthodoxy was perfect. But Paul had warned them in Acts chapter 20, as he was leaving after 3 years, he said, "I know that after I leave, savage wolves will come in among you and will not spare the flock. Even from your own number, men will distort the truth in order to draw away disciples after them. So Be on your guard. And now we have Jesus saying to them, well done. Verse 2. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked men, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. And Jesus names one particular group, Nicolaitans. They'll appear again in the third letter. Maybe we'll think a little bit more about them then. But they were certainly a group whose teaching was seriously flawed, especially in condoning sexual immorality. The Ephesian church hated their practices, and so did Jesus. In a world where the pressure for the church to compromise, and this was certainly one of those places, the pressure was always to stand in line and take a little bit of incense and sacrifice it to Caesar. But they didn't do that, despite the pressures to compromise. This church had no personal agendas. All they did was for the name of the Lord, verse 3. And in all this activity, they had not grown weary. Isn't that wonderful? What a church. Doesn't this church look perfect? I wonder what Jesus would make of our church today. You know, a church that may look good from the outside, well, that might not necessarily impress Jesus. Or a church that looks from the outside weak and small and failing, it might not look like that to Jesus. Because too often we judge by the standards of the world. But hasn't this always been the case? Man looks at the outward appearance. God looks at the heart. In this church, the heart was cold and empty. Verse 4. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Isn't that sad? Just to read those words, you have forsaken your first love. The church looked great, but they were doing lots of good things. But those were just things that they did. It was duty. It was tradition. It was, call it whatever you will, but it was no longer motivated by love for the Lord. They had perfect doctrine. They stood for truth, but it was cold and dead without love to make it live. So Jesus calls them to remember. Remember the height from which they had fallen. Those early days when they reached the heights of devotion to the one who loves them, but how easily they have slipped to the mediocrity of the plains, as John Stott puts it. They were backsliders. They hadn't just lost their first love. The text says they had forsaken him. That's serious, because forsaken is an act of the will. It wasn't just some kind of thoughtlessness. It was something more. Now, this is a warning to you and to me. Scripture commands us to love the Lord our God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength. Loving him is our first priority. If we let life squeeze him out, then we're in trouble. The Ephesians were busy doing good, but they were in big trouble because loving him was no longer the priority. Remember what Paul wrote to the Corinthians? You'll recognize these words, 1 Corinthians 13. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but do not have love, I'm only a resounding gong and a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor, give my body to the flames, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Paul says you can do as much as you want to do, but without love, it's worthless. Jesus told his disciples that on the day of judgment, there will be people who come and say to him, Lord, Lord, didn't I do this for you? And Lord, Lord, didn't I do that for you? And he said, I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Go away from me, you evildoer. So what can we do about a situation like this? What can they do and what can we do? The first thing to do is remember, verse 5. Remember. Remember what your relationship with him used to feel like. What it used to be like. Remember those times of worship when the Spirit drew you close, so close. Remember when you loved the Bible, when you were hungry to learn. Remember when you prayed about everything and entrusted everything to the Lord. Remember when you loved being with other believers, those who valued you and encouraged you. Remember when you used your gifts with joy. Look at where you are and remember where you used to be. Remember. And then again, verse 5, repent. Repent means to change your mind or to change your direction, to turn your back on all known sin. Don't continue on the path that has taken you away from him. Turn around and go the way that he is going, the path that leads to life. And then, as Jesus says, do the things you did at first. Do you remember how Peter had denied Jesus 3 times? Remember that? Then after the resurrection, Jesus spoke to Peter and he asked him a question. Do you remember what it was? Peter, do you love me? Peter had done something dreadful, something really dreadful, but it was not the end of the relationship. The important thing was, did he love his Lord? For everything is forgivable when you love him. The warning to the church in Ephesus was that if they did not repent, Jesus would remove their lampstand from its place. The church would disappear. They wouldn't be the light in the darkness any longer. No church, as John Stott puts it, has a secure and permanent place in the world. It is continuously on trial. Love for Christ is the measure of a church. But the letter ends with these beautiful words, verse 7. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. We last read about the tree of life back in Genesis chapter 3, when Adam and Eve, because of their sin, are put outside of the garden where they can't access the tree of life. But now here, by faith in Jesus, we have the right to eat from the tree of life in the paradise of God, heaven. What a reward that is. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. Some years ago, I wrote a song based around that text from 1 Corinthians. And then last February, just before lockdown, Debs and myself re-recorded the song and made a video of it. We're going to show it, and I'd like you to listen to the words of this song and just think about him. Think about the risen Lord. Ask yourself the question, do you love him? Or has that love grown cold? Or have you forsaken your first love? And if so, remember, repent, come back to him.
heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love Him. For those who love Him, the one who first loved me.
No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love Him. For those who love Him, the one who first loved me. I can't imagine what heaven's gonna be. There'll be no tears, there'll be no pain, there'll be no fear when Jesus reigns. And we will see Him, the Lamb upon His throne. And we will worship Jesus. The kingdom of our God will be our home. Imagine what heaven's gonna be. There'll be no tears, there'll be no pain, there'll be no fear when Jesus reigns. And we will see Him, the Lamb upon His throne. And we will worship Jesus. The kingdom of our God will be our home. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love Him. For those who love Him, who first loved me.
No eye has seen,
on this Sunday of the Word, we turn to You, our God, and bring to You our concerns for our world, our community, and ourselves.
For our Christian churches, that we may allow Your Word to penetrate our hearts, call us to life, and motivate us to lovingly serve You. Lord, hear us.
For Christian unity, that You will help us to heal the wounds and misunderstandings of the past and lead us to a united witness to the gospel through our service to our suffering and vulnerable neighbors. Lord, hear us.
For a great love of the Word of God, that we may take time to read, ponder, and pray with the Scriptures so that we may deepen our relationship with You, our God. Lord, hear us.
For all who are alienated or disconnected from You, that Your Spirit will continue to draw their hearts to the life and wholeness that is found in a relationship with you.
For those who are sick, especially for those with the coronavirus. That you would heal the sick, protect the vulnerable from the virus, strengthen the healthcare workers, and make the vaccines effective. Lord, hear us.
For greater care for the earth and its resources, that you will guide us in being good stewards of this, our home, and in protecting its resources for future generations. Lord, hear us.
Behold the Lamb upon the throne, the sons all brought to glory. Sing hallelujah to the Lamb and sing redemption's story. And all creation joins as one. The wretch is now God's treasure. By grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, forever. Thank you for joining with us today as we worshiped our amazing God. Hope that you've been blessed. We're going to finish our service by praying together. So let's all pray. So Father, we have come to you, people of the risen King. Father, we have sat at your feet to listen to your word, to bring you praise. Father, we thank you that we come to an awesome God, and we pray that as we go into a new week, that you will go with us. And so may his mercy pursue you, and may his grace renew you, and may his love embrace you all the days of your life. Amen.